Here are 10 things to do for better sleep. Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmeetails, just tell me what works. And today we're going to talk about 10 different things that you can try to get better sleep. So number one, get morning sunshine at the same time every day. Do it when it's bright out, do it when it's not so bright out, do it when it's cloudy. As long as it's not raining, go out. Even if it's cold, go out. I do this every morning, even in the winter. Some people think I'm crazy, but hey, if you have the luxury of having awesome sleep all the time, you don't have to worry about it. But if you could improve your sleep, then get outside every morning at a consistent time of day. It doesn't have to be immediately upon waking, but it should be in the first couple hours after waking. And it should be extremely consistent as possible. If your waking time ranges from 6 to 8, then make it 8:30 that you get your morning sunshine in so you can get it at a consistent time every day. Number two, eat enough food. If you're on a diet and you're trying to lose weight, don't be surprised if it hurts your sleep. You need to be in a caloric balance in order to have high quality sleep. And if you are chronically dieting or you're just so used to trying to lose weight, you might not be perceiving correctly what your food needs truly are. So try an online calculator that I'll link to in the description of this episode to estimate what you should be eating for calories. Try tracking your calories with MyFitnessPal or Chronometer and make sure you're actually eating enough food. Number three, eat enough carbohydrate. Now I'll say up front, some people sleep better on a high-fat ketogenic diet. Ketogenic diets are low in carbohydrate. But the thing is, ketogenic diets help relax you in certain ways by their actions on GABA in the brain. They also help your brain reduce its requirement for glucose by feeding it with ketones. But if you are not on a ketogenic diet, then you might need more carbohydrate than you think. You might need about 200 grams of carbohydrate a day. And that's because when you're not on a ketogenic diet, your brain consumes 120 grams of carbohydrate every day. And so if you're eating 90 grams of carbohydrate, you're eating too many carbs to be ketogenic, and you're not eating enough carbs to feed your brain. On top of that, your liver stores about 90 grams of glucose that it releases into your blood in order to sustain your blood sugar between meals. The greatest challenge on your liver to do that is overnight when you're sleeping, because that's the longest you go without a meal. And that means that you might need 120 grams of glucose to feed your brain, 90 or 100 grams of glucose to make sure that your liver is topped off at the end of the night, to make sure that your brain is getting fed and that your blood glucose isn't dropping. So I would think of 200 grams plus more if you engage in a lot of high intensity physical activity. If you're a heavy athlete, you might need 400 or 500 grams of carbs a day. But 200 grams for someone who's sedentary, who is not on a ketogenic diet, might be what you need. Number four, eat enough nutrients. There are so many nutrients that can impact your sleep that any one that's missing could be the thing that's compromising your sleep. So I'll link to an episode that I did called 5 Rules for a Healthy Diet that is designed to make sure that you're getting all your nutrients in without thinking too much about it. But you can also try tracking your nutrients with an app called Chronometer. I'll link to an episode I did about how to do that. And then of course, if you want to really geek out on it, you can do testing to manage your nutritional status. If you're going to get into that, you should get a copy of my Testing Nutritional Status, the Ultimate Cheat Sheet, which you can find at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet, and which you can get $5 off with the code LITE5. That's LITE and the number 5, LITE5. Number 5 is avoid blue light at night. There are different ways that you can engage with this concept. I recommend, if you have sleeping trouble, to engage with it intensely and regularly and consistently for a few weeks to see if it helps you. If you don't have a lot of trouble sleeping, then you don't need to be too mindful of it. But the simplest things to do are to not stare at a screen at night, like not stare into your phone for hours before bed, and to reduce the intensity of the light that you're that you're surrounded by. So if you have really bright overhead lights and you have some warmer colored dimmer lamps, use the dimmer lamps instead of the overhead lights. But to really get into it, I would recommend a few things. Number one, if you have software on your computer or phone that warms the screen at night, use it. Next, get a pair of blue blocking glasses so that at a minimum, you can use it when you're going to go into the refrigerator or you're going to go into the bathroom where you're going to be exposed to bright blue lights while you're otherwise blue blocking. And then lastly, get ambient lighting for your home that is low in blue light. I use light bulbs from lowbluelights.com that I turn on I shift over to them around 8 o'clock every night to get a warmer, lower blue lighting in my apartment. So I don't actually use my blue blocking glasses that much unless I'm gonna spend time staring into my phone or I'm using it to do things in the kitchen that require me opening the refrigerator and things like that. Most of the time, I'm just in ambient lighting that is low blue light. Number six, have a routine to psychologically wind down. You need to shut off your problem-solving part of your brain. You don't want to be thinking about your daily tasks. You don't want to be thinking about the things you need to do tomorrow. You don't want to be thinking about what could go wrong. You want to create a routine that takes your mind off of all those things. Some things that have helped me are writing down my to-do list for the next day to get it out of my head and onto paper, watching TV, watching movies, playing video games, reading paperback fiction. Find your thing that helps you wind down, that helps take your mind off the day-to-day needs, and spend a couple hours in that winding down routine at the end of the day. Number seven, sleep in darkness. Ideally, in your room, you want to block out all the outside light. What I do is I use inside-mounted blackout shades and then outside-mounted blackout curtains. And I also use a sleep mask on top of that. The sleep masks that cup the eyes are better than the flat ones. And I'll link to the one that I use in the description of this episode. Number eight, sleep in a cool environment. Keep the room as cool as you can handle without being uncomfortable. That's going to be different for everyone, but you want to sleep on the cooler side of what you tolerate, not on the warmer side of what you tolerate. If you want to get fancy, if you're married and you have different cool tolerances on one side of the bed than the other, there is a chili pad option that has the ability to keep one side of the bed a different temperature than the other. And I've heard that it has saved many marriages. Number nine, sleep with silence or white noise. I don't sleep with white noise, so I don't have good recommendations for it. I do better with silence. I use earplugs every night. One thing that I've always hated about earplugs is the way that you lay your head down on the pillow and they push back into your ear. So I started using Max PillowSoft silicone earplugs, which you shape with your fingers to be flat against your ear. The downside that I've heard from the ladies is that if you have long hair, your hair can get stuck on them. So if you have long hair, it might not be the best choice for you. But if you have short hair, it's a much better option than the ones that stick out of your ear, in my experience. Number 10, when you wake up to pee, handle it properly. I just did an episode that I'll link to in the description on how to not wake up when you pee. But if you do wake up when you pee, then a few things are important. Number one, practice 100% blue blocking on the way to and from the bathroom. So put on your amber blue blocking glasses on the way there while you're peeing and on the way back. And then when you get back, if you don't fall immediately to sleep, use an abbreviated form of your psychologically winding down routine. In other words, if video games helps you wind down, play video games on your phone with blue blocking glasses until you get distracted. If reading helps you wind down, then read a paperback book by either with your blue blocking glasses or with your ambient amber low blue light until you feel distracted enough to go back to bed. If you feel voraciously hungry when you wake up, then eat something, but keep in mind that you're probably not eating enough in general if you keep waking up hungry in the middle of the night. And so you should try to manage your daytime eating in a way that will prevent you from needing to wake up and eat in the middle of the night. Finally, put these 10 steps into a rhythm. Especially with the light issues, it's really important to have the darkness, the low blue lights, and the morning sunshine at consistent times of day. But it really is important for your body to sleep at a similar time every night. So if you absolutely have to sleep at different times in the weekdays and the weekend, do what you can to bring them together by shifting around your routines so that at least if it's not the same, it's similar. This episode is brought to you by Ancestral Supplements Grass-Fed Beef Brain. Our Native American ancestors believed that eating the organs from a healthy animal would support the health of the corresponding organ of the individual. Ancestral Supplements has a nose-to-tail product line of grass-fed liver, organs, bone marrow, brain, and more, all in the convenience of a capsule. For more information or to buy any of their products, go to ancestralsupplements.com. This episode is brought to you by Ample. Ample is a meal in a bottle that takes a total of 2 minutes to prepare, consume, and clean up. It provides a balance of fat, protein, and carbs, plus all the vitamins and minerals you need in a single meal, all from a blend of natural ingredients. It's available in original, vegan, and keto versions, portioned as either 400 or 600 calories per meal. I'm an advisor to Ample, and I use it to save time when I'm working on major projects on a tight schedule. It keeps my brain going while I power through the day, never letting food prep get in the way of my productivity. Head to amplemeal.com and enter the promo code CHRIS15 at checkout for a 15% discount off your first order. The audio of this episode was enhanced and post-processed by Bob Davodian of Torian Mixing. You can find more of his work at torianonlinemixing.com. For ad-free versions of these episodes with transcripts that you can read and getting early access to the episodes, often weeks or maybe even months ahead of time, you can sign up for the CMJ Master Pass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code LITE10 to get 10% lifetime discount. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next episode.